Beacon Press Audio presents When One Religion Isn't Enough, The Lives of Spiritually Fluid People by Duane R. Bidwell. This audiobook is narrated by Thom Rivera. Published by Beacon Press Audio, 2018. For Carrie, again. Introduction. Or Where I Stand. When NBA player Joakim Noah, a center for the Chicago Bulls, isn't on the basketball court, he wears a Christian crucifix and Muslim prayer beads. Some days, he also sports an Ethiopian cross made with Tibetan Buddhist stones. "I believe in God," Noah says, "but I won't say that I'm a certain religion. I think I'm a little bit of everything." In The Life of Pi, a best-selling book and an award-winning film, the main character calls himself a practicing Hindu, Christian, and Muslim. Asked by a priest, an imam, and a pandit to choose one religion, he declines, "I just want to love God." Some well-known Buddhist teachers in North America were born and raised as Jews. One of these teachers has rewritten the Psalms from the Hebrew Bible as Buddhist prayers. During the 2008 presidential campaign, one of the most contentious questions about Barack Obama wasn't about politics, but concerned religion. Taught by Catholics, taken to Christian churches and to Buddhist temples by his mother, influenced by a Muslim father who also honored animism and Hinduism, and now worshiping at a Black Christian Protestant congregation, is Obama a Christian, a Muslim, an agnostic, or something different altogether? Obama received Christian baptism, but even after his formal religious affiliation was made clear, CNN famously asked, "Is Obama the wrong kind of Christian?" Religious multiplicity, the experience of being shaped by or maintaining bonds to more than one spiritual or religious community at the same time, is occurring more frequently in the United States and Europe. In other parts of the world, religious multiplicity has long been a norm. As more and more people transgress religious boundaries, this multiplicity becomes more visible. We increasingly encounter spiritually fluid people in public life, at school, at work, at backyard cookouts, and at the health club. Spiritually fluid people evoke prejudice and curiosity, uncover assumptions, and disrupt our typical labels. They undermine religious authority, complicate religious communities, and blur social categories. Their lives question ordinary assumptions about pure, static, and singular religious identities. Above all, spiritually fluid people spark questions. How and why does someone become spiritually fluid? Are spiritually fluid people simply confused, syncretistic, unable to commit? Are they idolaters? How should we make sense of spiritually fluid people? Do they belong in our religious and spiritual communities? What might they teach us? And what do complex religious bonds imply about our own religious and spiritual identities, practices, and commitments? This book explores multiple religious bonds as a human experience. It describes religious multiplicity rather than evaluating it. It asks how people come to claim, or be claimed by, religious multiple identities, practices, and lives, and it concludes that religiously multiple people belong among us. Their visibility and voices bring gifts to benefit our communities and our common life. The lives of spiritually fluid people pulse with complexity and contradiction. One person's experience could never exhaust what it means to be formed by two or more religions. By necessity, then, this book includes contradictory voices. Those voices tell stories and make points far different from mine. I celebrate these differences. Still, no writer can transmit another person's stories without shaping them. A retold story never comes to readers in as pure a state as when the original storyteller entrusted it to a writer. We tell stories, even other people's stories, for our own purposes. We make them do what we want. Because the stories in When One Religion Isn't Enough have percolated through my mind and intentions, they've absorbed meanings and flavors that weren't there at first. Even if I quote someone directly, you're not hearing the tale the way the person would tell it. You're hearing my account of the experience. This translation process scares me a bit. Telling other people's tales is a privilege. They entrust their words, thoughts, and feelings to me, and I can distort these even without trying. Nonetheless, I'm accountable to the people who shared their stories with me. I'm also accountable to readers. Throughout the book, I've tried to convey, with accuracy, responsibility, and sympathy, the voices of spiritually fluid people. I know many through friendships, research, counseling, and spiritual direction. I've also tried to convey the ideas and voices of scholars who think and write about the topic. My intention is to create a thoughtful and reflective book, one that doesn't tell people what they should think or experience, but takes a clear stand when it seems necessary. I rarely make judgments about which beliefs or ideas are the most true or legitimate. Nonetheless, I disagree with certain voices in the book, so it seems important to clarify a few of my beliefs. Where I stand. I am Buddhist and Christian. Jesus is my Savior, and the Buddha is my teacher. Jesus restores me over and over again. He gives life. He heals, although not usually all at once, and sometimes that healing can be painful. Jesus asked me to be honest with him, to be present to him, and to agree to measure my life against his. For me, Jesus is divinity con carne, holiness with meaty ribs, an ultimate reality that breathes and sweats and feels. He enables me to see and hear and feel and understand mystery with a capital M, by which I mean the ultimate sources, identities, meanings, and truths that orient human lives and give them meaning. I am Christian primarily by God's action and invitation. I affirmed that identity through baptism, but I did not request or choose it. God acted first. But it's hard for me to follow Jesus. I need a schematic, a rational step-by-step guide to waking up to mystery. Jesus doesn't provide that. The Christian Bible, after all, isn't a user's manual or a book of rules. It's a collection of vignettes, a gathering of voices. Attempting to live like Jesus requires art, not science. He teaches with metaphors and parables, not flowcharts. Jesus just doesn't provide a well-marked trail you can follow directly to your final destination. This is where the Buddha comes in. His teaching is coherent. He provides a precise 8-step path toward awakening and an overarching account of reality, or metaphysic, that fits a Western scientific worldview. The philosopher Alfred North Whitehead once said, somewhat too neatly, I think, that Buddhism is a metaphysic in search of religion, while Christianity is a religion in search of a metaphysic. I am Buddhist primarily by choice. Receiving nourishment from both traditions satisfies my longing for both a metaphysic and a religion. It gives me wise teaching and loving practices, a holy relationship, and a path to awakening, sustenance I wouldn't have if I were only Christian or only Buddhist. Yet my connection to Buddhism isn't only pragmatic or instrumental. It claims me emotionally, too. I am more apt to feel tearful or joyful when chanting at the temple than when I am worshiping in church. Buddhism changes the way I know and experience God. It broadens and deepens my understanding and experience of Christianity. Likewise, Jesus helps me understand more fully why the Buddha insisted that virtue, meditation, and wisdom must be linked. Jesus calls me to action in the world in ways the Buddha does not. I have a relationship with God. I have admiration for the Buddha. I don't need to justify my complex religious bonds. In fact, not needing to defend themselves is a fundamental right of spiritually fluid people. But I do want to position myself philosophically and theologically so that readers know where my feet are planted. My stance shapes what I see in the landscapes of this book. First,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.